الرجيم.
وإذ قال إبراهيم رب اجعل هذا البلد آمنا واجنبني وبني أن نعبد الأصنام رب إنهن أضللن كثيرا من الناس فمن تبعني فإنه مني ومن عصاني فإنك غفور رحيم. ربنا إني أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم ربنا ليقيموا الصلاة فاجعل أفئدة من الناس تهوي إليهم وارزقهم من الثمرات لعلهم يشكرون.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم.
وإذ قال إبراهيم رب اجعل هذا البلد آمنا واجنبني وبني أن نعبد الأصنام رب إنهن أضللن كثيرا من الناس فمن تبعني فإنه مني ومن عصاني فإنك غفور رحيم. ربنا إني أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم ربنا ليقيموا الصلاة فاجعل أفئدة من الناس تهوي إليهم وارزقهم من الثمرات لعلهم يشكرون.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I welcome you once again to لا إله إلا الله. Worship your Lord. This kalima, brothers and sisters in Islam, which will save us on Judgment Day. It can take us straight to Jannah without a question asked, provided that you fulfill the concept of tawakkul. Tawakkul, reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't ever divert your focus. The heart. The means, yes. Talk to the person, ask him, would you like to help me? I would like to get the job, but in my heart, if Allah wills for me to get the job, I will get it, whether you like it or not. But I will dress nice. I will, call and find out about the company before the interview, and I will smile when I'm being interviewed. See that? There is no conflict between the reliance of the heart and pursuing the means to achieve something, because the means are a component of tawakkul. The means are a component of tawakkul. When those people from Yemen used to come to Hajj, and they used to refrain from bringing provision with them, food or money that can be used to pay for food and lodging, And when the people in Mecca would ask them, why are you doing this? They would say, نَحْنُ الْمُتَوَكِّلُونَ. We are الْمُتَوَكِّلُونَ. We are relying upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No. Allah revealed, وَتَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. وَتَزَوَّدُوا. Take your provision with you. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I'm sorry, yesterday I could not do the class. So today, inshallah, we're going to do La ilaha illallah. Short one, inshallah. And right away, we will get your question answered, inshallah. Today is lecture number 7. This is the book. And by the way, there will be a new cover, a new thing. But lecture number 7 today, inshallah, the grave worshippers oppose the messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the book is being edited right now, the two parts, which is the grave worshippers pitfalls and refuting Yasir Qadi blunder of grave worship, you know, furnishing the evidence that this is complete shirk, not just a bid'ah as he claims to be, inshallah. So inshallah, the book is being finalized right now. Hopefully it will be available for you, inshallah. Today, like we mentioned in a previous lecture, that the grave worshippers and the innovator in general, the innovators, Ahlul Bidah, whether the extreme Sufis, Maturidi, Badududu, and all these isms out there, they oppose the categorization of Tawheed. So that's the first thing they oppose, which is Tawheed, the concept of Tawheed. They critique us when we say Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, Tawheed al-Asma' wa Sifat, or whether when we say Tawheed al-Ma'rifa wa Tawheed al-Talab, or whether we say the existence of Allah, the Lordship of Allah, the names and attributes of Allah, and the worship of Allah. You know, we have the three categorization, the two categorization, and the four categorization. They oppose that. For them, Tawheed is the Lordship. That's it. As long as you believe and recognize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, the sovereign, that's it. That's all. You're a muwahid. You're class one, level one, muwahid. طيب, what about the worship? No. The worship is okay. You can call upon rifa'i tijani with Allah. The attributes, you can give al-rifa'i al-tijani, the attributes of Allah. We don't have tawheed, asma' sifat, we don't, you're getting that. So they oppose, because they want to confine tawheed to what? Lordship. And this is where this brother came in and he said what? As long as they don't believe in the divinity of the engraved. You're getting that, you're getting the trick here. So you still believe in the Lordship of Allah and you do not give divinity to the engraved, it's not shirk. Only shirk if you believe that. If you violate the Lordship. Yeah, but invocation is an act of worship, which is part of Tawheed. And in reality, you're giving that person also attributes of Allah. He is dead and now you're saying that he hears you. You're getting that. Today, we want to show you how the grave worshippers oppose the messenger of Allah, even though they claimed his love, but they oppose him. I will share this with you, inshallah. Allah, his messenger, affirmed the primary wisdom: Muslims visit the graves. It is an admonition of death and a reminder of the hereafter. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in hadith akhrajahu al-Imam Muslim, كنت قد نهيتكم عن زيارة القبول ألا فزوره. So, why do we visit the graves? To go and pray there? No. The curse of Allah is upon us. In order to go and invoke shirk. Why? Why do we visit the grave? Why do we go to the cemetery? To make dua only? No. I tell you no too. Why? Because I could make dua for my father who is buried in Egypt, in America. You see, do I have to go and stand by the graveside and say, oh Allah, this is the one, please, oh Allah, and have mercy on him, oh Allah. This is a defect in your aqidah if you believe that. That you have to, I hate to say it because it's blasphemous to say that. Yes, al-deen hurik, yes, it is a reminder of death. For the living, admonition for me. Why? Because when you go and visit somebody that you know, imagine this person used to eat with you, used to drink with you, drink water, used to go to the masjid with you, and subhanAllah, he's no longer there, right? That's an admonition. أَلَمْ يَهْدِ لَهُمْ أَوَلَمْ يَهْدِ لَهُمْ كَمْ أَهْلَكْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ مِنَ الْقُرُونِ يَمْشُونَ فِي مَسَاكِنِهِمْ أَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّ أَهْلَكْنَا قَبْلَهُمْ مِنَ الْقُرُونِ أَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. Can they see that people die and they don't return to them anymore? The people who die, they never come back to our world anymore. Isn't that sufficient for them? Huh? It's admonition, is an admonition, a reminder of death. And that is what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said. كنت قد نهيتكم عن زيارة القبور ألا فزوروها فإنها تذكركم بالموت بالآخرة. Those two. I used to forbid you from visiting the graves. Now, visit the graves because it will remind you the living with death with the hereafter. And even if we look at the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we find out that many things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated on the tongue of his messenger for us to remember death. Like زور المريض واتبع الجنائز, visit the sick and follow janazas, right? And so forth. طيب. Now, brothers and sisters in Islam, it is permitted to visit the grave site, but with certain restrictions. Here they are. We shouldn't restrict it to specify day and time. Some people, some culture, they say the day of Eid is ziyara. They will like ziyara on the day of Eid. No. On Jum'ah, on Thursday, bid'ah. In Egypt, we have that Thursday thing. No. You can visit at any time. Imagine Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam visited the graves of the buried companions in al-Baqiyah at night. The story, the famous story of Aisha when he made dua for them. And he raised his hands. So we cannot specify. Once you specify, then bid'ah right here. We should treat the engraved Muslims kindly when visiting them by greeting them with greeting of salams, making dua for them, praying for their forgiveness. The famous dua, As-salamu alaykum dara qawmin mu'mineen, antum as-sabiqoon, wa inna insha'allahu bikum lahiqoon, nas'alullaha lana wa lakum al-afu al-afi. The dua inside the Imam Muslim, which you all know. Fatiha and stuff, unestablished. Recitation of the Quran, unestablished. Bid'ah, right? Where do you find this from? Listen, your intention is to benefit the deceased, right? That's your intention. Who can verify whether the benefits is delivered or the benefit is delivered to the deceased or not is Allah. Now you got to stick to what Allah tells you what to do. Don't make up your own stuff. Like khatm al-Qur'an, like all this stuff. You see, there is no evidence. Listen, your intention is to satisfy the social order and the societal norms and the cultural practices, or to benefit the deceased. What is your intention? Oh, benefit the deceased. Then you should stick to what Allah said, what the Messenger said. It is permissible to raise the hands facing the direction of the Qibla, not the grave. To face the hands, facing the Qibla, not the direction, not the grave. And raise your hands and make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. طب what if the qibla and the grave coincide the intention now? Be careful. Don't even remember this person. Like some of the scholars said, who's engraved is like someone who's drowning. Think of him like someone who's actually drowning, sinking in the ocean. And every time you make dua is like a rope, you pull him up. But who? Allah. Don't think about him having any la. What else? It is forbidden to sacrifice animals at the gravesite. Some people go and sacrifice animals at the gravesite. And they say this animal is for Allah, Qurbani. Ya akhi, Qurbani is slaughtered at home or the slaughterhouse. Why do you have to take it to the graves? It's very funny. Very funny. طيب. Making tawaf also around the grave. It's not allowed. We must refrain from saying anything which would anger Allah. Like, you know, why did he die? Why did you take my husband? Why did you take my son? La. Listen, grievance is something that we cannot stop you from enduring. But you have to exercise patience. Accepting the decree of Allah is something that is recommended, which can happen later. عبوديه الصبر وعبوديه الرضا. First, exercise patience. Then, inshallah, if you do that, Allah will enable you to accept the decree of Allah. Because nothing happens unless there is something good in it. But sometimes it takes patience. Go and look at the story of Musa and Al-Khidr and see how many times the word patience and its derivatives been repeated in that small portion of Surah Al-Kahf. إِنَّكَ لَمْ تَسْتَطِيعَ مَعَيَ صَبْرًا وَكَيْفَ تَصْبُرُ عَلَى أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكَ إِنَّكَ لَمْ تَسْتَعَ مَعَيَ صَبْرًا and so forth. طيب, we must refrain from praising the engraved. Oh, you go there and say, oh, he's in Jannah. This guy used to do that. He used to teach on the internet. Allah knows best. Run. Allah, ya ikhwa, if anybody praises you, it's only, يعني, Allah is making them think good about you. But you know who you are, and what you are, and what you do. يعني, a statement which really paralyzed me personally. When Abdullah ibn Mas'ud would come out of his house and he would see all these masses waiting for him in order to teach them one hadith. And they would go around him and circling him to ask him questions. لو علمتم من نفسي ما أعلم, let's use this one, you would throw sand on my face. If you know what I know about myself, you would throw sand on my face. There is another one that says you will beat me up with the shoes, with your shoes. Alhamdulillah. It is forbidden to walk between the graves and step on them wearing shoes. It is forbidden. There is a hadith regarding that. طيب. So these are the etiquettes for a valid, permitted visitations. Now, let's look into seven things. And I just chose seven things the grave worshippers do, and by doing them, they oppose the instruction of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we cited some of it. What they do? Number one, they fail to understand Tawheed, and I'll explain. They turn the graves into places of worship. They praise the engraved excessively. The Sheikh Tariqa, the Al-Ghawth, they misinterpret the Quran. Setting trips to other than the three masajid, making tasawir, erecting statues and shapes, domes, shrines, mimicking the non-Muslims. Subhanallah, seven deadly things the grave worshippers do. When someone goes from his locality to a grave site, where someone is buried. شيخ طريقة, الغوث الأعظم, التجاني, الجيلاني, you know, any of that. You see, when you go there, you violate all of these. Number one, you really misunderstood the kalima. Because what tawheed is? لا إله. No deity. Right here, you're going there. Yes, even though you say لا إله إلا الله with your tongue, but your action reveals the contradiction. That you're saying La ilaha and yet you're going to that engraved dead person whom we actually don't know. You know, we discussed the subject of do the engraved hear us or not. We discussed this in a previous lecture. I mean, it's something that is not really settled because some Muslims, yani they say it's some settled. Some one of the brothers sent me something and saying this sheikh said it's they hear us. You see, what did the sheikh say of an evidence? You know, don't say the sheikh, say the evidence. At least is a subject that is not يعني, set. There are many evidence that says that they don't hear us all the time. In certain cases, yes. Exclusive cases, yes. Like we explained. Do engraved hear us? Huh? And you go there and you call upon this person. Whether you use him as intermediary between you and Allah or any of that. So, a violation of Tawheed, of the first half of Tawheed. And the first half, brothers and sisters in Islam, is a key. By the way, unfortunately, a lot of Muslims, they assume that as long as they believe in Allah, without fulfilling La ilaha. You see, if you look at the kalima, La ilaha, you have to fulfill that first. Illa Allah. Some Muslims, they believe as long as you believe Allah, La ilaha, not important. La. Look after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this beautiful verse, which is the greatest verse in the Mus'haf, which we call Ayatul Kursi, which talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, almost 17 to 19 attributes, 17 or 19 attributes of Allah are mentioned. Subhanallah. After Allah tells you who He is, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm lahu ma fi as-samawati la ikraha fi ad-din qad tabayyana ar-rushdu min al-ghayy. Now the path to guidance, the path to misguidance are made crystal clear. Faman yakfur bit-taghuti, whoever disbelieves in al-Taghut. What is al-Taghut? And this is something that will I explained in the actual book of La Ilaha Illallah when I initially wrote it. I would say compiled it. What is al-Taghut? Kullu ma'ubida ma'allahi radiya. Anything which is worshipped beside Allah, wanting that. You have to place that restriction to take Prophet Isa out. Take righteous people like Jilani. We hear Abdul Qadir Jilani, that was a follower of the Sunnah, a follower of the proper Aqeedah. But the people made these things out. And many people, I mean, those people, Tijani, Jilani, Rifa'i, Badawi, they could be righteous. Allah knows. You see, Allah knows that. You have to remove that. You have to make sure that you implement La ilaha, which is what? Al-bara'u min al-shirki wal-kufri wa ahli illa Allah, illa huwa al-wala. And this is always the Allah, look eh, wa ila thamuda akhahum saliha Allah ta'budu illa Allah, Allah ta'budu illa Allah. لا إله إلا الله. وإذ قال إبراهيم لأبيه وقومه إنني براء مما تعبدون. براء, البراء. إلا الذي فطرني, الولاء. فإنه سيهدين. ولا والبراء كلمة هذه. طيب the prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in more than one place in the Quran in the Sunnah, حديث أم سلمة وعائشة وجندب ابن عبد الله لعن الله اليهود والنصارى اتخذوا قبور أنبيائهم وصالحيهم مساجد, that you turn the graves into places of worship. And remember the first class, the first lesson, just go into how shirk originated in earth. That was the one trick that Satan managed to do with the people of Nuh. You guys miss Waddan, miss Suwa'an, miss Yahuth, Ya'uq, and Nasra, build places of worship around. Build a masjid, come and sit and pray next to the masjid. First, you pray to Allah. You pray to Allah. But then it turns into a generation after generation after generation after generation. Turning the graves into places of worship. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, imagine, Allahumma la taj'al qabri wathanan yu'bad. Oh Allah, do not turn my grave into a place where people worship. No. No, we cannot do that. Of course, when they go there, Ya Rifa'i, you are this, Ya Tijani, they praise the engraved. Subhanallah. فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ ولله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض ليجزي الذين أساءوا بما عملوا ويجزي الذين أحسنوا بالحسنى الذين يجتنبون كبائر الإثم والفواحش إلا اللمن إن ربك واسع المغفرة هو أعلم بكم إذ أنشأكم من الأرض وإذ أنتم أجنة في بطون أمهاتكم فلا تزكوا أنفسكم هو أعلم بمن اتقى. Don't ever praise yourselves. Yourselves or others. Allah knows who is the righteous and who is the pious. So you find these grave worshippers going to the grave. You are this, you are righteous, I can get my, please give. Excessive. One of the Yemeni scholars, his name is Abdul Rahman al-Muallimi. In his book, the book is called The Tankil. إِنَّ مِنْ أَوْسَعِ أَوْدِيَةِ الْبَاطِلِ الْغُلُوُّ فِي الْأَفَاضِلِ. One of the most spacious gateway to shirk, to misguidance, that you exaggerate the status of people, that you speak about them in a way that they are not human. Number four, they misinterpret the Quran. If you talk to a grave worshiper right away and you try to debate with him regarding the culture of grave worship, normally his agenda is to propagate it, is to promote it. And like I always, you guys heard me saying this before, brothers and sisters in Islam, if you really want to know the difference between the people who are on truth or on the truth, على الحق, and the people who are on falsehood, the people who follow the truth, they compile the evidence, and they formulate their beliefs and their actions based on that evidence. You're getting that? So, يَسْتَدِلُّونَ ثُمَّ يَعْتَقِدُونَ. So they first look for the evidence, and they just don't pick and choose evidence. They compile the evidence in a certain mas'ala in everything. العام والخاص, الناسخ والمنسوخ, المطلق والمقيد. They combine everything together. And they sort it out. And based on this compiled, on these compiled textual evidence, pieces of evidence, and after sorting it out using the tools of usul al-fiqh, how to deal with the text, how to derive evidence, derive actions, I'm sorry, from the evidence, ahkam from the evidence, huh? Following this process, then they believe and they act. But the people who follow innovation, the opposite. They believe, then they fish for evidence. That's how they do it. So he believes that the grave worship is the right thing. Khalas, shubha. Shubha is a misconception in his heart. ولذلك سبحان الله البدعة أو الشبهة كما قال سفيان الثوري أحب إلى الشيطان من الكبيرة. Shaitan would love for you to have a misconception, شبهة about the religion. For Shaitan, this is much better than you indulging in a major sin. Major sin is haram, but Shaitan prefers a شبهة in the religion. Why? Because the person who commits that شبهة or a victim of that shubha, he believes that this is the religion, that is the truth. You're getting that? So the grave worshippers, they believe that it's okay to pray in a masjid where there is a cemetery, or a cemetery in a masjid, a grave in a masjid. It is okay to go and visit the engraved and call upon them, and it is a stepping stone. It is evil, but it's not shirk. You know, all that. You see, first, he believes. Then, what does he do? He fishes. He tries to manipulate evidence. Manipulate evidence. One of the most famous pieces of evidence which the grave worshippers or the propagators, the people who seek to advance this tradition in the Muslim world and find justifications for it, is the famous verse, فَقَالَ الَّذِينَ غَلَبُوا عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِمْ لَنَتَّخِذَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ مَسْجِدًا. Yeah, famous. They normally use two evidence. The fact that the Prophet's grave in the masjid, which is, we refuted before, we said no, it was not like that to begin with. The masjid and the grave were completely separate. And when Abdul Malik ibn Marwan added them together, scholars rebuked him for that. And we know that prophets have to be buried where they die. So we cannot move him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have to leave him there. But the famous verse which they use is the debate which the people had regarding what to do with the young men who hide or hid in that cave for 300 years. So they debated. Look at the verses. فَقَالَ الَّذِينَ غَلَبُوا عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِمْ لَنَتَّخِذَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ مَسْجِدًا. Those who won the debate, غَلَبُوا عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِمْ, let's build the masjid around them. So they use this as an evidence. شوف the Quran. The people of the cave, and come on, this is easy to refute two ways. Number one, غلبوا على أمرهم here does not reflect that they are adherents to the religion, to Tawheed. No, they were the powerful people. And subhanAllah, in this verse, as if there is an indication to the 318 Nicaea conference, the conference of Nicaea, which the Christians held in the city of Nicaea, which is Istanbul now, and they debated who is Jesus. Is he the son or is he a messenger? And who won the debate? The people who are in power, the people who were alliances of the emperor, Constantine, because his mother was one of the followers of the Pauline theology, the religion which Paul, the self-claimed disciple who never met Jesus, invented, which is followed now. So غَلَبُوا عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِمْ does not mean that they were adherent to the Tawheed. لا. No, they were just more powerful, that their opinion took its the imperial powers or the political powers became an element to force their view. طيب, hypothetically here, for the sake of argument, suppose that the religious adherents, the people who really follow the religion, were the one who really suggested, let's build a masjid around their tombs, around their graves. طيب, does this become an evidence for us? Always, brothers and sisters in Islam, when you bring something from the past, there is a question that you have to ask. هل شرع من قبلنا شرع لنا? Is the Sharia of the previous nations is also our Sharia? Who can answer that question? Yes, if there is nothing that contradict it. No, if there is something that contradict it. Like what? The Sharia of the previous, they used to use lots. The, you know, the coin toss is permissible in Islam. Why? If your two children are fighting, you could arbitrate between them using a coin toss. The Prophet mentioned that if people would know the virtues and the merits of adhan and observing salah in the first lane, the first line, they would fight and to sort out and resolve that conflict, drawing lots. So it's permissible. Now it's permissible. But now we're talking about graves and building domes, shrines, visiting, all of this. لعن الله اليهود والنصارى. Allah curses the previous nations. اتخذوا قبور أنبيائهم وصالحيهم مساجد. They have taken the graves of the righteous people and their prophets as places of worship. ألا إني أنهاكم عن ذلك. ألا إني أنهاكم عن ذلك. ألا إني أنهاكم عن ذلك. Three times. وقالها, يعني there is no chance for abrogation. The narrator of the hadith, I believe Jabir ibn Abdullah, if I'm not mistaken, or Jundub, one of the two, he said it 5 days before he died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But there is no chance here for what? Abrogation. نسخ يعني, نسخ الحكم. No, there is not an evidence. طيب, what else here, brothers and sisters in Islam? They set trips to other than the three masajid. You see, that's another point that you need to pay attention to. The Prophet said, لا تشد الرحال, حديث البخاري, لا تشد الرحال إلا لثلاث مساجد. You're not allowed to leave your homeland, your house, and to travel to another place to pray or to do an act of worship, except in three places. المسجد الحرام, مكة, المسجد النبوي, مدينة. And that is why we tell the brothers, when you go there, you're not going to visit the Prophet, the grave. La, you're going to visit who? The masjid. The masjid. And the masjid happened to be next to the Prophet. Then go and remember death. Huh? And المسجد الأقصى, may Allah free it, يا رب العالم. So you will find those people doing that. They actually go and they try to travel. They go to Pakistan or India or Egypt. We have Tanta, البدوي. هذا حرام. You're opposing the instructions, the commands, the prophetic commands, the Prophet who cares about you. And now you claim that you love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, making tasawir around the graves. What is tasawir? Erecting, you know, making pictures. And if we really wanna admonish them or ourselves regarding this particular issue, is remember the people of Nuh. How the shaitan came to them in a human form and he said to them, what? Guys, you miss Waddan wa Suwa'an wa Yaghuth wa Ya'uq wa Nasra. Your heart are breaking. You miss them. Just erect statues which resemble them. And A'udhu Billah, don't worship them. No. Just erect them while they're reciting the Quran. So when you see them reciting the revelation, then you recite the revelation. Erect them when they give sadaqah. Well, isn't that what you used to love about them, right? So erect their images when they are actually engaging in the things that you like to see them doing, that you used to like seeing them doing while they were alive. Next generation, shaitan is very patient. When he plants a seed for shirk for him, I can wait 300, 400, 500, 600 years. Imagine 3 generations until he finally instilled shirk in the people of Nuh. And 3 generations, by the way, if we look at the lifespan of Nuh, his da'wah only 950. Scholars said that he lived 1400 years. Imagine this is the lifespan, not like me and you now, 67 years, and if we reach that. Huh? So imagine 1400 plus 1400 plus 1400, add up, that's 3000, 1200, 4200 years. Imagine that. That's how patient he is. In order to do what? In order to place shirk. Imagine Prophet Nuh spent 950 years calling them to leave the worship of Waddan, wa Suwa'an, wa Yaghutha, wa Ya'uqa, wa Nasra. And then you have the brother, he said, oh, it's a stepping stone. It's evil. It is opening the door. It is, but it's not shirk. Ya Salam. Ya Salam. Ya Akhi Rabbul Alameen yaqul fajtanibu al-rijsa min al-awthani wajtanibu qawla al-zur. Stay away, اجتنب الفاظ التحريم من أعلى الفاظ التحريم في نصوص الشرع الاجتناب. The highest style of prohibition, not to do it, لا, stay away from it. Like Allah said to Adam عليه السلام, and he said to us regarding adultery and intoxicants. Enough that you're mimicking the non-Muslims, and that's number 7 really. You're mimicking the non-Muslims. You see, who does this? The Prophet mentioned that they are the people of the book. So these are, brothers and sisters in Islam, some things which show you how the grave worshippers are not adherents to La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. That their religion is hawa, desirous religion. We have 15 minutes left, inshallah. If you wanna give us a call, 303-500-5101. I will post the line here. We're done with the class today, alhamdulillah. I know it's Ask Imam Kareem today, but I'm sorry, last night I couldn't do the class. So that is 303-500-5101. So give us a call, inshallah. And if I can ask my admins as well to post these questions, if there is any. So now we're going to open the floor. 303-500-5101. If we can get somebody trying the phone lines also. So it's a WhatsApp and a regular phone line, inshallah. Please give us a call, inshallah. Okay, my admin already sent me a question. Imposter. Okay, let me pick up our first caller here. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi
wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
My question is regarding, especially in India, Pakistan, and maybe other parts of the world, you write, all people write the name Maulana. Where is Maulana? Is that an attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
It's permissible, you know, but again, the intention of the people should be pure. And also, you know, anytime, Brother Nazir, you praise somebody, you gotta remember 2 things. That you do not lead the person to develop self decide, or I don't know, there is a verb there that I know it exists, self bright. If you know that when you say that to him, you know, he will be proud and all of that. He should avoid that in principle. But the word Mawlana, because al-wilaya for the believers, the Mawlana is a derivative of al-wala, that you are loyal. I'm loyal to Allah, to the Messenger of Allah, and everyone who is also loyal to them. Yeah. So the word Mawlana is a derivative of that. So it is permissible, but again, the intention is important. And the impact which will make if you say it to somebody is important as well. Jazakallah khair, Brother Nazir.
Thank you.
Let me see here. What happened? Yeah, Sheikh, I'm very sick. And when I recite Surah Al-Fatiha in Salah, I start cough over and over again to the point that I start tremble, and that causes me to forget which verse I was in. Keep reciting it, imposter. Keep reciting it. If you forget which verse, Surah Al-Fatiha is not a long surah. Just go back and recite it from the beginning. Permissible for me to recite Surah Al-Fatiha over again? Yeah, I guess that's the answer. I answered you there. Okay. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Call your life. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Name, state and question, please.
My name is Abu Zaki. I'm from Canada.
Abu Zaki from Canada. And your question, Abu Zaki?
My question is, well, it's more a remark. I see that you have tackled the topic of La ilaha illallah again, and somehow revisiting the topic of, you know, people who say that making dua on a qabr is actually not shirk. I would say some people might say,
brother,
why?
Oh, brother, yes, brother, sir. Did I say making dua on qabr not shirk?
No. You okay. Did not say. I'm okay. Just saying that you are taking that topic again because just to remind people that making dua on a qabr is shirk, is actually shirk. Okay?
Well, again, when I raise my hand facing the qibla, and I'm making dua to Allah for the buried person is permissible. Even though I could make that dua somewhere else. But making dua next to the grave of a righteous person, believing, I'm sorry, I have to make this crystal because, you know, words can be inserted there. Making dua next to the grave of a person you may consider righteous, pious, or he has a status, thinking that this dua will be accepted or answered, believing that is certainly an act which will lead to shirk, and this is how the people of Noah got into shirk. If you go and you talk to the engraved thinking that they hear you, they can help you, this is completely shirk. So let me just reword this, so this way you are clear. Go ahead and ask your question.
I actually missed that second part, but my point wasn't here, Yasir. My point is, sometimes people would say, why do we continuously talk about La ilaha illallah, but somehow forget that we do have to talk about La ilaha illallah continuously, irrespective of what topic we are tackling. And today, for example, I would say we've been talking a lot about, you know, what's happening in Palestine and our brothers in Palestine in Al-Aqsa, but we do have to remind people also that these topics, these issues are also related to our da'wah towards La ilaha illallah.
Excellent.
Muhammad Rasulullah.
Excellent.
Just a reminder that wherever we topic we take, it converges to Tawheed, it converges to La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah.
You want to hear that beautiful statement? Ad-deenu, the religion, all of the religion, is aqeedah, is belief system. Tanbathiqu minhu shari'ah. And out of that la ilaha illallah, the belief system, branches out the actions, the things which we do. وَلَا يَقْبَلُ اللَّهُ مِنْ قَوْمٍ شَرِيعَتَهُمْ إِلَّا إِذَا صَحَّتْ عَقِيدَتُهُمْ. And Allah will never accept, make successful whatever you do, unless the foundation is sound. Jazakallahu khairan. All right, let me see here. I still have a couple of more questions. Zizibo, I'm buying a car and paying 50% cash, financing 50% at 3 interest rate. If pay the balance within a year, the interest will not apply, which I intend to do. Is it okay to sign? No, it's usury. You're signing a usury. Just go and buy one of these cars, 0%. That's even, you know, if you have the ability to pay it off, that's much better. But you signing to pay 3% usury is haram, is haram. Reem, assalamu alaikum. Sheikh, is shirk to put a country's flag on the top of a mosque? No, not really. You know, it's okay. It's permissible. You know, there is nothing wrong with that. You know, if you're sending a message, you know, because Palestine is the place where Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is, and this is where, unfortunately, the people turned the whole thing of Palestine into a Palestinian conflict. And I had a whole khutbah about this last Jumu'ah. Maybe Brother Ismail can post it for you, inshallah. Okay, guys, I'm worn out. I'm getting tired. And I can tell that you are done too. Inshallah, tomorrow, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we will have a question and answer session. Oh, tomorrow we have the Maqasidik Tafsir. Sorry, Maqasidik Tafsir. And Wednesday, Thursday, we'll have another question and answer session, inshallah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I love you all for the sake of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep you safe and sound. Couple of announcements before I go. We have on-site summer camp, only if you live in Denver. Okay, this is going to be fun. Look at that. Fun, June 7th to July 29th, 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Only if you live in Denver or if you're willing to move to Denver, we'll take you, we'll allow you to come, we'll give you a visa to enter Denver. What about that? Now, we do have another announcement here, which is really good. We're done with the summer camp. We have a virtual summer camp, virtual summer camp, so you can disregard that. So we have a virtual summer camp. The fundraising, we're done with that, please. Just look to your left screen, summer camp, that's a virtual. I'll be teaching Islamic studies myself, and I'm looking really very much forward to that. 2 days a week, imagine that. 2 days a week, Saturdays and Sundays. 2 hours on Saturday, 2 hours on Sunday. And I'm really looking forward to that. So sign up your kids, guys. You're really gonna enjoy it, inshallah. Of course, Safa USA, we're having our first orientation this Sunday, guys. Safa USA, right here. The first ever virtual Islamic school, very affordable, $295. We'll give you discounts if you qualify. But this is your thing. Go and visit www.safausa.org and sign up, because orientation is on Sunday already, brothers and sisters in Islam. What is Safa USA? Do you guys want to know what Safa USA is? No? Okay. What about that? Here you go. The first ever Islamic full-time virtual school, K-12. and Islamic curriculum, and you're going to love that, inshallah. Life instructors. Life instructors. Hafs program and all of this. Jazakum Allah khaira. We'll see you tomorrow, inshallah. I love you all for the sake of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim.
وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا وَاجْنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ أَنْ نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامَ رَبِّ إِنَّهُنَّ أَضْلَلْنَ كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ فَمَنْ تَبِعَنِي فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي وَمَنْ عَصَانِي فَإِنَّكَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ رَبَّنَا إِنِّي أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم ربنا ليقيموا الصلاة فاجعل أفئدة من الناس تهوي إليهم وارزقهم من الثمرات لعلهم يشكرون.
من الشيطان الرجيم.
وإذ قال إبراهيم رب اجعل هذا البلد آمنا واجنبني وبني أن نعبد الأصنام رب إنهن أضللن كثيرا من الناس فمن تبعني فإنه مني ومن عصاني فإنك غفور رحيم ربنا إني أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم ربنا ليقيموا الصلاة فاجعل أفئدة من الناس تهوي إليهم فاجعل أفئدة من الناس